एक्स्ट्रा टाइम।
हंड्रेड बोले तो सौ क्रिकेट के सबसे अहम चीजों में से एक है। या तो आप 100 मैचेस कंप्लीट करें, 100 विकेट्स कंप्लीट करें, 100 कैचेस लें, 100 आप स्कोर करें, 100 एक लैंडमार्क अचीवमेंट होता है। हेलो नमस्कार गुड इवनिंग, मेरा नाम है अभिषेक, एक्स्ट्रा टाइम लाइव में स्वागत है आपका एक बार फिर से। और मेरे साथ आज तीन एमिनेंट गेस्ट रोज की तरह, और एक गेस्ट तो बहुत ही स्पेशल है क्योंकि वो बहुत दूर से हमारे साथ है, ऑल द वे फ्रॉम लंडन। वी आर जॉइंड बाय जैरेड किम्बर, सीनियर जर्नलिस्ट, वेरी वेरी पॉपुलर गाय एंड वेरी पॉपुलर अमंग द क्रिकेटिंग सर्कल्स। हाउ आर यू टुडे?
Yeah, very good. Thanks for having me on.
Great. Along with Jared, of course, we have my own friend Siddharth from all the way from Delhi, ex Hindustan Times, also very popular among the cricketing circles. Kaise ho aap, Siddharth bhai?
I'm good. I'm finally getting the COVID vaccine. Finally, after 4 weeks of trying.
Congratulations. And we have a man who already has 2 doses of COVID vaccine, that too on one single day. Devashish Sen from Kolkata. How are you?
Thanks, Abhishek. Thank you.
Right. Okay. We're talking about 100. 100 is about to start in England. It will start mid of July. There are many forms of cricket that are going on. We have Test cricket. We have T20 cricket. We also have T10 cricket. And now we have the 100. So I'd start with Jared. How excited is the cricket fraternity out there and the cricketing fans especially regarding all the prospects of the 100?
I think it's pretty split. I think there are a lot of people who are upset that the 100's going to end county crickets and, you know, the cricket that a lot of people grew up loving. And I think there's a lot of people who like cricket who don't really understand why the 100 needs to exist. But then there's a huge other point out there of people who realize that cricket has really slipped in the UK. And what needs to happen is something needs to reignite the fan base. And that's essentially what the ECB are trying to do. So it's very split. If you have a look, when the 100 tweets something, have a look at the replies. It's overwhelmingly angry county fans having a go at the ECB for the tournament itself. So there's certainly a lot of that. But I think there's a really interesting generation of younger cricket fans coming through in the UK who actually grew up watching the IPL on free-to-air TV. So there's a very long time where you couldn't watch cricket in the UK for free unless it was the IPL. So there's this people under the age of about 26 who grew up with the IPL. Now, sadly, the IPL's gone to pay TV, so it's gone the same direction. But for a long time, I think a lot of them saw that as the future, and therefore they're very much on board with the 100. But yeah, everyone's waiting to see whether it's going to succeed or fail. And realistically, it'll be like the Big Bash, won't it? It'll probably be somewhere in the middle.
Right. Okay, I'll ask this question in Hindi to Siddharth. इतने सारे क्रिकेट के फैंस हैं एंड इतने सारे फॉर्मेट्स भी आ गए हैं अब क्रिकेट के, क्या आपको लगता है कि अब 100 की भी जरूरत थी या शायद T20 पे ही ज्यादा फोकस करते तो ज्यादा बेहतर रहता उनके लिए भी?
I mean, if I have to take forward Jared's point, like, there is a demand. That's why the ECB thought about ki theek hai, let us do the 100. Let us try something novel. Neither a T20, neither a T10, but it's somewhere in the middle if you have to look at it. A hundred ball match. I mean, it may sound novel, but again, jaise aapne introduction mein kaha tha, there is already a T20, there is already a T10, there is already an ODI, there is already a test. When the IPL began, every country had their own spawning of T20 leagues all around, the Caribbean Premier League in England, the Vitality Blast, the Big Bash League. Now, the addition of one more format, I don't know how commercially viable it will be, considering that players are pulling out. It's also the time of the pandemic, although pandemic is easing off in the UK. So, bahut se sawal aise hain, like how viable it will be. Already, the 100 has been jinxed from the very beginning. Why in 2020 it was postponed due to the COVID situation. Now here, even some players are threatening to pull out. Some have pulled out because of the quarantine issue. Either the international calendar is too cramped. So it remains to be seen. And also, in a very twisted way for the Indian fan, the Indian cricket test team cannot play anything from June 23rd to August 4th, ironically because of the 100. because none of the players are in the 100. Only the luckily the women's team are there from India. So yes, I agree with Jared. There may be a mixed reaction, and it depends how the first match goes, how the logistics take place, how grandly it is presented. That will be the key.
Right. I think Jared, you were trying to put in a point.
No. I was just agreeing. I think this is the worst time to start a new tournament, right? And they are not copying the IPL. They're really more copying the Big Bash. And so what the Big Bash did was it allowed for children to come and families to come to the cricket. So cricket games in England are very, very heavily... The only families you ever see are really Asian families who come in a group. Mm. More often than not, English cricket fans are white males who come on their own, right? And what the Big Bash did was, I went to a Sydney Thunder game where all the kids were there, and it was a completely different environment, and that is what the 100 are trying to do from that perspective. The problem is that you're doing that in the middle of the pandemic, and not everyone's going to be especially younger families probably won't be vaccinated as much. People still aren't going to go out and do things at the same level. They're having 10,000 people at Wembley coming up soon. So you've got all those sorts of problems. On the format problem, right, let's be completely honest. The ECB could not have stuffed up the promotion of this tournament, the release of this tournament. Like on one of the early meetings, they couldn't even explain what the 100 format was. They couldn't explain what this 10-ball over was and how it would fit into the tournament. And what the reason it's 100 balls is because the BBC said it had to be finished within 3 hours. And they were desperate to have it on the BBC, right? And, Trent Woodhill, you guys might know, was a coach with RCB. He's the person hugely involved with that. And he was the one, I don't know if the 100 balls was his idea, but he was involved in all those sort of mad ideas with the ECB. And I said to him, if you just bowled 10 overs from one end and then bowled your next 10 overs from the other end, you would take out the extra half an hour every time anyway, because half the time in cricket, we're changing ends is what's taking so long. You could still have 120 balls. So the sort of errors that they have made along the line, I heard the other day that they are now, the ECB has the rights to this so that they can sell it as a franchise. Why would anyone buy the 100 as a thing? Literally, if I wanted to rip this off, I'd just do a 90-ball tournament or 105-ball tournament. I'd call it Levi's 101 or whatever you have to do to get around. It's such a ridiculous thing. So the extra format really comes from them not understanding how they could do something great. One of my big problems with T20 cricket at the moment is we have these incredible fielding athletes like Ravi Jadeja and Ben Stokes and Fabian Allen and Kyron Pollard and David Warner. They spend most of their time in a cricket game running from end to end at the end of the over. I want all their energy to be when they're fielding. So there are so many mistakes made by the ECB, but the basic core of the thing is that they are going after new cricket fans, younger cricket fans, and family cricket fans. I promise you this. My wife has seen cricket in Australia and in England. When she goes to Australia, she takes a pram in with her. They go, okay, well, this is where you can put the pram. Here's where you can change the baby and all this sort of stuff. The first time she tried to get a pram into Birmingham, I literally had to call up the head of Edgbaston Media and say, my wife can't get in. Right? That is how poorly they are set up for families. So that is why England, the ECB is pushing all this sort of stuff. But they've just got a lot wrong on the way there.
But Jared, if I have to just take your point out of new fans, hasn't the Vitality Blast and other T20 leagues gotten in the newer fan base, say in the generation of 21 to 30? Hasn't the attendances risen pre-pandemic?
The attendance is fine in that blast, but you can't get... I don't think that tournament is ever going to take off on TV. That's the difference. And also, what the blast tends to be, and this is different for different grounds, but, certainly at Surrey and Essex and some of the grounds that are really have big crowds, it really is a drunken football crowd, right? Which is absolutely fine, but not particularly what cricket is trying to grow as. And, what the IPL was bringing at was really getting women to watch cricket. We don't talk about this enough, but that's essentially one of the great things the IPL did. And what the Big Bash has done is similar, maybe not quite as many women, but quite good on women. Premier League football, right? Again, a huge women viewership. That's what you really want to grow. And as a general rule, you probably don't want to head into the Oval on a Friday night to a blast game where half the blokes there have turned up after work already drunk. What you want is a different kind of environment. And I think that is what the 100 is going towards, to make it a more open environment for especially that, you know, the Caribbean cricket culture in England has disappeared. They're just not involved in cricket anymore. That's gone. So they have to try and get that culture back. The Asian culture, there's a big chance a similar thing would happen with that in the future. And you would be left with basically lads who like to drink and kids from upper class families going to the cricket. That is the ECB's worst nightmare, right? And so the 100 has been designed the opposite around that. Get it on TV so a grandma who watched cricket when she was a kid can watch it with her grandkids, you know, so that people can stream it and so they can watch people do stuff on TikTok and all those sorts of things. And the Blast, I think in a perfect world, the Blast can continue to go because it almost serves a different marketplace. It really does serve something else, whereas the 100 should be a TV and streaming product where kids can come to the ground.
Right. I mean, in a nutshell, we can say that the 100 is like a Salman Khan film. They're losing the script to make a family audience come to the ground.
Yeah, for sure.
I think I'd rather not go into the Salman Khan tangent here because we may get a lot of hate mail. We may get a lot of trolling. As you know, how Bhai fans are very, very, very polite, you may, if I may say. But I think, again, 100 has again fallen foul, probably due to the pandemic, not because of fans, not because of the overall situation, but because of the quarantine-related logistics and other related logistics and everything. Now the international calendar is getting even more cramped. You are deliberating whether you can play the IPL. Now that is just a nutshell what we are going to experience. The 100, although it's in mid-August, some England fans, England stars will miss it because the first two tests will happen. The international stars already from the West Indies or from Bangladesh or every other thing, they will have quarantine issues. How do you manage that? You can't play the 100 after September because that's the end of the season there.
Right.
I think proper timing. I think this is the first time that they will telecast it logistically, have fans. Let's see what happens. But again, another addition with too many formats. I don't know whether it will aid cricket. Maybe it might benefit the ECB in the short term. Because some accidental innovations do work. Kerry Packer, who would have thought color clothing would work in the 70s? It was scorned upon, but it worked. 92, color clothing, daylight cricket, two new balls. Who would have thought that it would work? It worked. It was spectacular. Now, let's see how the 100 does it. But I think already T20 format was the zenith of innovation. T10 is struggling to pick up. 100 is also... Let's see if it will test the waters now. Let's see.
Right.
I would like to add to the point is that, you know, obviously, you need big stars. For any global tournament, you need big stars. And who at the moment are the big stars? You need stars, who need entertainers. And who better than someone like Virat Kohli or Rohit Sharma? I wonder, you need to have the Indian players playing in global tournaments like the Big Bash League or the 100 for that matter, or Vitality Blast. See, IPL, why is it so popular over the years? Because the basic thing is that they have formulated the tournament in such a way that they have created their own window where you get all these players, all these overseas players coming and playing and taking part in the IPL. Maybe that is what I would call a hindrance for other leagues that are not successful enough compared to the IPL. Because you need big star players so as to generate more interest. You need players who are star players like a Virat Kohli or a Rohit Sharma or a Jasprit Bumrah to play in the 100. Because we do have the Indian cricketers, four Indian cricketers, women cricketers who would be part of the 100. But then I totally agree with Jared because having been to England and covered cricket in England, I have seen lot of Asian community, they throng around the stadiums to watch cricket. So I think maybe ECB is trying to get in more women, more children, because if I am not wrong, because if you go to grounds like South Africa or Australia, you would see lot of kid activities during the interval, during a test matches, during the lunch break, they have a kids cricket or something like that, so as to involve the kids and also get their parents to bring their kids into the stadium. So maybe that is my kind of a way so as to popularize the game in cricket. But then England, we all know, is a mecca of cricket. I mean, test cricket is still the number one sport in England. As far as test cricket is concerned, I would say that England and Australia are still the most, if you consider crowd, I think these are the two countries that get the maximum number of crowds in test matches. So what was the point of having a new tournament like the 100?
No, and Devashish and Jared, one more thing. If you look at the IPL, it is done when no other domestic season overlaps it. The IPL is exclusively played in a season. Whereas in England, the county overrides it. The international fair summer overrides it. That is one problem. Even in Australia, the Sheffield Shield, the Big Bash League, they are secondary when the Australian summer happens. In India, in particular, there is no Ranji, there is no Vijay Hazare, there is no international commitments at that time. So the proper window, which is allocated to the IPL, is proving to be a detriment in the case of the 100, when in the near future, whether there will be a fixed window, we don't know about it. But if it is successful, Jared, where will the ECB slot the window for the 100?
Well, they'll just put it in the middle of the summer if it's successful. A lot of the stuff, when you're comparing it to the IPL, they're not comparing it to the IPL. As I said, they're comparing it to the Big Bash. So what did the Big Bash do for Australian cricket? At the point of time that the Big Bash came on, Australian cricket was slipping away to become a minority sport, right? We still got big crowds for the tests. I mean, you know, you're definitely right there, but it was no longer the biggest sport in Australia. It was no longer this huge, thing that everyone talked about. The Big Bash brought it out and made it a TV event every night of the year. And it doesn't matter. The Big Bash doesn't need AB de Villiers or Virat Kohli or Rohit Sharma. Not to say that they wouldn't be bigger if they could get those guys all the time, but they don't need it because that isn't what that program is. What it is a program where every night of the summer, you can turn on the TV and there's cricket on, right? That's all the 100 needs to be now. It needs to be good enough that you've got, you know, Ben Stokes and you've got Johnny Bairstow and you've got Josh Butler. As long as those guys are playing in it more often than not, because that's a huge problem with the Big Bash. But as long as those guys are playing with it every night and you've got cricket on every night, you can then sell that and start to grow it as an overall product. And then you bring the kids in. I don't think the ECB are thinking that they're not thinking, oh, we will be a competitor to the IPL or we will be the next big thing. What they are thinking is we can be a side thing, and we need to start. So they need to start off at the ground roots. They have no ground roots. You talk about the stuff about kids in Australia and South Africa playing cricket around the ground. Cricket isn't even a school sport in England anymore. You don't kids in state schools do not play cricket. You know, in India, in Asia, you go anywhere on a beach in Sri Lanka, someone's playing cricket. In Australia, during the summer, everyone's got a cricket bat. South Africa, similar thing. Even in the black communities, a lot more cricket than you will ever find in the UK. There was a photo recently of a couple of kids in, I think it was in Yorkshire or Lancashire, playing cricket on the street. The photo went viral because of how weird it was that people were playing cricket on a street in the UK. Right? Like, think about how silly that is compared to what we're talking about. That is where cricket has fallen to in the UK. So, yeah, it would be great if they could get Virat Kohli and Rohit Sharma. But if I was the BCCI, I'd probably never allow that unless I wanted my players to get more experience in those conditions, right? But that isn't what it needs to be. What it needs to be is a consistent TV product where there is only – the problem with counter cricket is there are so many damn teams that no one can even remember them. Half the people in the UK couldn't even find Derby on a map, right? You know, we're not talking about a massive place here. And they don't have the same kind of following basis that the football clubs do either, right? It's a different kind. What they're trying to create is something, is a franchise system where any young person can go, oh, there's eight teams, this is the closest team to me, and every night of the week, I can watch a game of cricket on TV. They have to keep it as simple as that. If it becomes successful, it will have its own window, right? And Test cricket will be played at the start of the summer and the end of the summer, and they'll play the 100 in the middle of the summer on their own. But they have no idea if it's going to be successful. I mean, let's be completely honest. They're copying the Big Bash, right? The Big Bash, right. Australia is a city-based place, right? Melbourne is a big city. Sydney's a big city. Even Adelaide's a big city. there's only like three big cities in all of the UK. They don't have big cities. People are spread out in the UK. And, you know, London is massive and Manchester and Birmingham are quite big. But, you know, Cardiff's not very big. And you got some of these other teams. They're going to be a composite of two different northern places. No northerners like each other. They're not going to enjoy that. So we don't even know how this is going to work. But that's why they're taking all these chances, is because if you've got – they have a game show in the UK called Pointless, right?
Yeah.
And the idea is to get an answer where no one has come up with that answer before. If you know anything about cricket, you win a pointless every time, because the general public has absolutely no idea who any of these players are outside of probably Ben Stokes.
Well, that's some interesting and deep things that we got to know about England cricket. All right, I'd like to throw a different angle on the 100 and want to know all of your views, gentlemen. Is that, will it be very good for women's cricket as well? Because you'll have matches along with men's cricket and you have a global audience. You have equivalent prize money. So if you think the angle of women's cricket, the 100 will be beneficial to them more than others. Let's start with Jared.
Yeah, I mean, it's huge for women's cricket. I started covering women's cricket in 2012, and the quality of women's cricket was so poor at that point. There was talent there quite clearly, but so many of the players just couldn't dedicate their time to it. You know, I remember the amount of times I've talked to a women's cricketer, and she said, you know, I had to choose between paying my mortgage or playing cricket. Like,
right.
And so many of the best players, we don't even know them. They just disappeared because they couldn't play. Having the ability to have domestic players as professionals. So a lot of the countries around the world have international, professional, but have the domestic players as international, as professional is just a huge step up. You go and watch a women's Big Bash and these women are clearing the ropes. Like they have the ropes in so small now and these women are just smashing sixes over cover, right? Because they are now hitting the gym and they're now working on swing arcs and clearing the front leg and all that sort of stuff that women cricketers weren't even told about 5 years ago. And so it's a huge step up for them. Essentially, once you match money with sport, the level of sport goes up. And with the men, most men in the world, even if you play for Zimbabwe, other than Ryan Burl, apparently, but even if you play for Zimbabwe, chances are you're going to have access to a livelihood. The women, domestic women up until recently, did not have a chance to have a livelihood. So having an extra tournament, I mean, it's an absolute disgrace what the BCCI have done with the women's IPL. I mean, it's not a women's IPL, is it? It's like a stupid exhibition tournament. Yeah. They about 5 years ago, India could be the best women's team in the world by a factor of 100 already, because all they had to do is go, well, we'll just take a chunk of this money that we have and we'll throw it at women's cricket, and they would dominate every level of women's cricket forever. And who was the first country to do that? Australia. They are now the best women's cricket team that we have ever had, maybe the best cricket team we've ever had, right? That's how good the Australian women's team are at the moment. And that all comes from paying the women to play and then paying to have domestic players play and then having a tournament where they are treated like professionals. It is that simple for women's cricket. You treat them like professionals, they'll play like professionals. And for too long, we never did that.
Right. So that,
I mean, imagine this. Look at the pay discrepancies that we've got. And the general excuse that why women are kept back in India is, oh, but they don't generate revenue. But if you don't play much, I mean, how do you expect them to get the revenue? I mean, look at this. Virat Kohli, grade A plus, gets 7 crores. The lowest in the BCCI contract list is 1 crore. 1 crore. Right. For the women, the highest is 50 lakhs. 50 lakhs.
Right.
That is 14 times lesser. Another correlation, the likes of Smriti Mandana, the likes of Harmanpreet Kaur, how did they become the best? By playing in the Women's Big Bash League. They got the chance to play for the Sydney Thunder, the Hobart Hurricanes. I mean, the WBBL in Australia has pushed women's cricket to such a huge benchmark. Meg Lanning's team, 24 consecutive ODI wins. 5 T20 World T20 Championships. Look at the investment that Australia have made. And in India, we are not even going past revenue. That is how myopic we have become. I'm at least glad that the likes of Shefali Verma, the likes of Harmanpreet, Mithali also, they're all getting a chance to be in the 100. The pay factor, equivalent pay to the men, that might be the one USP which will tremendously boost Indian women's cricket, because for far too long, before Anurag Thakur, women's cricketers did not even have a contract system in India. They did not even have a grading system. Now, at least with the contract system, now their eyes have opened up. Okay, let these guys go to the WBBL, let them go to the 100. 364 days, where was the outrage? Where was the outrage? The Indian women's cricket did not play a single game. Australia did, England did, West Indies did. For crying out loud, even Pakistan played against South Africa.
Right.
This is where I think the 100 is a blessing for the women's cricketers in India, especially for India. Because, come on, a four-day women's IPL, I'm sorry, that is not a tournament. It is just a sideshow. And look at the importance given to it. Played when there is a couple of days break between the IPL league game and the playoff. That's right. The importance that you're giving. And it shows that there is still a lot of prejudice to be escaped in India. So, 100 is a blessing along with the WBBL for India women's cricket. But yes, we only pray that the ECB executes it pretty well. It's had a bad start, postponed from 2020 to 2021. I just hope now that they do it. And it serves out well for the women's cricket, at least for Indians.
Right. I just want to add one thing to that. When I think it was in 2018, I went to a women's Big Bash game and I cornered a couple of the batting coaches and said, tell me why women are hitting more sixes now. And he said, before they would work 9 to 5, right? So they either hit the gym at 7 a.m. or 6 a.m. before they went to their day job, or then they finished training between 5 and 8, and then they tried to hit the gym. And half the time they were too tired, right? Because now they just hit the gym. They can hit harder because they hit the gym. Imagine that. Something as simple as that has gone from women barely being able to hit the ball over the inner circle to Harmanpreet Kaur hitting the ball over cover for 6 and all sorts of shots that you see from women now. We're not even saying they need to be paid, 7 crore. We're just saying if you pay them and I'm not talking about 12 women, I'm talking about 80 women, right? If you pay them, out of that 80 women, you will get an improved performance out of all of them. And then you will get a bunch of other women or young girls going, wow, that's a job now. It's little things that we could do in cricket.
Right. Devashita, you're itching to say. No, please.
Yeah, I totally agree with Jared, because that is what the Isha Guha has also mentioned a couple of days back, about that if BCCI would have invested a lot more with women's cricket, then things would have been a lot more different. See, after 7 years, we are playing a test match against England. That says the story. That itself says the story. And we are playing a test match against Australia after 15 years. Thanks that it is a day-night test match happening. And obviously, you make the girls to play a day-night test match when they have no experience of playing a test match for 7 years. They don't have any experience of playing ping ball games. And you suddenly get them to play a day-night test match against a team like Australia, who have already played one test match, one day-night test match, if I'm not wrong. So, so people will, then if suppose they are not doing well, then you will say that, oh, come on, we gave them an opportunity, but then see the performances, they haven't done well. So, that is what is not fair. So, you should have given them a lot more opportunity to try and get used to playing with the ping ball. Perhaps get them some practice matches before you get them to play the test match against Australia, which was not the case. And then again, the same thing, playing a test match after 7 years, could you believe it? When Australia and England have been playing regularly test cricket, you have the Indian women's team playing a test match after 7 years. That itself says everything about it. So the more the BCCI invests on women's cricket, the better for Indian women cricketers.
Right. All right, very quickly, all three of you, I'd like to know, although it's very early, but still, I'd like to put you in a spot. So I'd just ask you, out of 10, if you had to rate the 100, how much would you rate? We'll start with Jared.
Based on the organization and everything they've done so far, I give it about a 7 out of 10.
Quite high. Okay, Siddharth.
Looking at how it has evolved, I mean, in 2020, it was postponed. Now they're really trying hard in 2021, at least for the effort bit. I will give it 6. 6 out of 10. Okay. Let the matches happen. After that, we'll see what happens.
Yeah. Okay. Devashita.
One thing that ECB needs to be patted is the way they have been, that the 100 has been promoted. Means ever since the inception, the way it has been promoted, the globally, and you see getting the big stars to and the comment. I think if you ask me, obviously the ball is yet to get rolled. But if you ask me, I would still go with Jared. I would also give them 7 out of 10.
Great. Thank you so much, gentlemen. And it was a pleasure speaking to you. Looking forward to again joining you in an interesting adda over cricket. Thank you so much. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jared. Thank you.